derivative itself, the derivative gives you equilibrium, it is the next expansion level. The second derivative that really is telling, it would tell you whether the structure is stable or not. So, as a result you want to go to a second order, and this is the second order expansion of cosine phi. If you expand cosine phi around 0 using Taylor's expansion, this is what you get. Keep that in mind, and then we did all this analysis for dynamics, and we said that in the case of dynamics, if your response would be like depending on what value of omega square you get, if it is omega square is greater than 0, you are going to have a bounded response. It would be oscillatory, but it would be bounded. That means it is not approaching to infinity or anything as t increases. If omega square is equal to 0, the response is a straight line, but it keeps on increasing. If omega square is less than 0, then it is a hyperbolic response, and this is the kind of thing we see in divergence. Okay, this is the kind of thing we see in divergence, and the response just keeps on increasing in a hyperbolic manner. All right. So these are all the things we talked about yesterday. Any questions about what do we mean by adjacent, the method of adjacent equilibrium, and the dynamic equilibrium method to evaluate the stability of a system? Those are the two key methods, and the third one is you look at the energy, but we are not going into that one in this course. And these are some of the equilibrium paths. As you start to increase the value of p on that bar, nothing happens. Okay, you will go along this vertical line. That means that p keeps on increasing, but theta remains 0. The moment you reach here, it can either go to right side or to left side, and that generally depends on what kind of imperfection you have in the system, because systems are not really perfect. So, if the system has a slight preference to go to the right path, it will go to the right path. If it has a small preference to go to the left path, it would go to the left path, but there is the third path going, keep on going straight. But that is an unstable solution. That means if you give a small disturbance along theta equal to 0, it would immediately switch to either to the right or to the left. Okay, so coming, we're going to go to the divergence again. But before we go to divergence, I want you to refresh your memory in terms of buckling, because buckling plays a big role in our understanding of stability theory. So, this is a very simple beam, it is simply supported on both ends. How many of you know already about buckling? Not okay, it's quite a few. So, I'll be rather quick. So, you have a simply supported beam, it can be any support, does not matter. So, you apply a compressive load p. Now, let us suppose I give it a small disturbance to this beam. What would happen is the beam would come back to its original condition. Now, I increase the value of p, I give it a small disturbance, it again comes back to where it started from. If I keep on increasing the value of this compressive load, there comes a time at that value of the compressive load, if I give this beam a small disturbance, this beam would stay where I leave it. I mean give it a disturbance and I release it. Okay, so when I say give it a disturbance, you give a disturbance, but then you have to release that disturbance. So, I give a disturbance and I release it. What would happen is the beam would stay there. It will neither go further in that direction nor would come back. What do you think is happening? Why is that happening? You know my question, right? Say that again, please. Say that again. I know that, but why? That what is it that's bringing it back? What is it that does not want it to? So, what is the restoring force in this case? The bending moment, the bending stiffness, right? So, what is trying to keep it there? why should it stay there? When what I told you guys is, if this is my beam, it's generally look better if you drive vertical, because then you can do a simple experiment when you go home. You can take a straw and try to push it from the top. So what I'm saying is, I give it a small disturbance, it comes back. I increase the value of load, I give a small disturbance, it comes back. I keep on increasing the value of this load, but there comes a time, if I give this disturbance and I release it, it stays here. It does not either come back, nor does it move, go become unstable. So my question to you is, what might be happening? That is, yes, you guys are absolutely right that when the beam deflects, the bending stiffness would like to bring it back, right? I mean, that's the whole idea of elastic stability. Elasticity is, you apply a load to a structure, but when you release the load, the elasticity of the structure would bring it back, right? I mean, that's the thing. So there is a what we call restoring moment. What is the value of that restoring moment? Just anybody remembers? Say that again. What's the restoring moment value? What's the bending moment that restores back when we release a bending moment? EI d square v over, right? So that is our restoring moment. Everybody agrees, right? So what would keep it here? What is trying to keep it? If I draw a big free body diagram now, if I apply the load here, this is the moment that is this guy, right? So over here, if I draw the shear force bending moment diagram, what's going to happen is this moment, it wants to keep it going, right? But I think this would be this way. This moment wants to bring it back. There would come a time when this moment would exactly equal to this load times this deflection, right? So at that time, if I release my load, it is not going to come back. It's just going to stay there. Now, if I increase P plus delta P, what would happen? This moment does not change, right? This is fixed. It is EI is fixed. I can't change EI. But this load now is the load that is trying to bend it more, P plus delta P into delta, that now would be higher, right? So it's gonna just keep on taking it to more and more deflection. So that's what happened. The restoring moment becomes less than, you give it a small disturbance, because this small, when I apply this load over here, at this time, what this beam, this point is seeing is that this load is trying to deflect it, to rotate it or bend it, right? But the internal stiffness of the beam does not want it to do that. It says, no, we're going to come back where we started from if you release the disturbance. So at certain value of P, then the beam, we call it a critical load, and the beam would stay where it is, and if P becomes greater than that, the beam would continue to bend more and more, and it's going to become unstable, and the deflection, mathematically speaking, goes to infinity. Okay, but in practice, either the beam will break before that, or the nonlinear effects will take over, and it will not. That will not happen. Okay, so but mathematically speaking, what we say happens is, if this is our P, this is our deflection. As P increases, deflection would keep on going up. Sorry, deflection would stay zero, but I can keep on increasing the value of P. At certain value of P, I start to develop those adjacent equilibrium, and to the first level, they would be stable like this. And mathematics says it's going to go like this, either this way or that way. What happens in reality though is, as this beam deflects more and more, it develops internal in plane forces, okay, that in like strings. If you pull a string, so the nonlinear effects come into picture, so the actual displacement might be something like this, okay. So the actual displacement might be that you still have need to increase load if you want to increase the deflection, or if there are imperfections it might be in fact something like this. So right from the beginning you start to develop a deflection. I mean this is very pure mathematics, that beam is perfect, only then it stays on that path. If beam has any imperfections, like I am telling you, go home and do with straw, the straw is going to have some imperfections. So right from beginning you will develop some deflection, okay. It is not zero deflection, and then you start to go on a path like this. And if it is some kind of metallic beam, then you might also develop somewhere over here some plasticity, and that might start to bring it back like this, okay. So this is generally what happens, because plasticity start to make it soften, the internal in plane axial force makes it stiffer, the mathematical behavior is this, the real behavior could be something like that, okay. So let us see how do we derive equilibrium equations for this case. So let us say you are pulling from the force N on this side, and the interesting thing in all this is, this is happening in the presence of axial load, but we are really keen to learn the behavior in the transverse deflection, okay. So what we want to see is, what is the effect of this axial load on the transverse deflection behavior of this beam. So the first equation is dN over dz equal to 0, why? Because I am not applying any distributed axial load. If I did have some distributed axial load on this, then this would be dN over dz equal to that distributed load from simple equilibrium. So we get everywhere you have a compressive load, okay. So this is simple, our P over, so this is our shortening displacement, P over EA is shortening displacement, but this is not what we are really keen about. We know that the beam is going to be shortened little bit at that value of P, but what we are interested in is not knowing this little compression at the end of the beam after I have applied P. What I am interested in is, once I have applied P, what happens to the transverse behavior, okay. So what happens to the transverse behavior is very interesting now. So the first part is simply that this end has gone little bit to the in, but that inward movement is very very small, okay. So what I am interested is now what would happen after that, and if I give it a transverse displacement like this. So the key thing there is that the length of the beam remains same. So when we study buckling, you would always see that people would represent the left end by a fixed end, completely fixed, cannot move, but on the right end they will put rollers, okay. So that means when I apply the load now, after it has compressed due to the compression, which is very very small, PL over EA is very very small, we do not care about it. What we care about is, now once it starts to deflect, this end is start to going to move inside. Why would it start to move inside when it buckles, or when it you give transverse deflection? Because the length almost wants to remain constant, right. So in one case you have a straight line, and every time I make a small differential element into an angle, if this point stays here, obviously the second point is going to move in little bit, right, because this length is same as this length, okay. So that is what we mean by end movement inside, okay. And that is very important, because that is what gives us potential energy. So you can very easily find what that inward end displacement is from this very simple relation. So you have you could show that V prime this D, so this you can show, I mean we can just draw the equilibrium first and then worry about that. But just I was telling you that that is something you need to keep in mind when you, if you use the energy method. So this is now all your forces, two shear forces. On the left we have a shear force V/1, on the right we have a shear force V/1 plus dy1, bending moment Mx, bending moment Mx plus dmx, a load p here, and the load p has shifted on the other one, like I showed you over here, that the load is now over here. I mean the load moves along with your where the beam deflects, the end deflects. So this is a very simple equilibrium equations, sum up all the moments about x is coming towards u is 0, and you get these are all very nice classical equations, and you already have told me this law many times. Okay. So when you do all this, you get a beam equation under the action of axial compressive load that looks like this. Okay. This should have been only 2 primes, not 3 primes. There is a mistake here. This should have been only 2. This is up to here, it is fine, but then when we differentiate one more times, this should have been 2 primes here, this should have been 2 primes here, 2 primes. So there is a mistake in my slides, this one really should have been 2 primes, because the governing equation is d square dz square eix v double prime equal to 0. Plus p d square v over dz square equal to 0. Okay, so the actual equation is d square over dz square ei xx. It should be d square v over dz square plus e. Equal to 0. So essentially what compressive load does is it adds this new term into the mix. Okay, that has become now your equilibrium equation. When the load is compressive, the beam loses its transverse stiffness, it becomes less stiff under transverse loads. If P is tensile, it becomes more stiff in bending, resisting bending. So it's like a guitar. You know, guitar. You pull the string; it's lot more difficult to bend that guitar string because it's under lot of tension. So tension helps you resist bending. Compression makes life hard. Okay. So under compression, your buckling, your transverse deflections would be much low, much higher than otherwise. Once again, I need to correct this. Correct it as right away. This should be V double prime. Okay, I need to fix that. All right. So then the boundary conditions, that was the governing equation. To solve the problem, you need boundary conditions. It depends on what kind of ends you have. The simplest one is pin. So V is 0 and the moment is 0. Then the clamped free, we have been talking about clamped free a lot. If x equal to 0 is clamped, the deflection is 0. And the rotation is 0 at x equal to 0. At the free end, the bending moment is 0 and the shear force is 0. Okay, so those are the boundary conditions. At clamped, both deflection and slope are 0 at both the ends. right? And clamped pinned at x equal to 0, deflection is 0, slope is 0, but at the pinned end on the other side deflection is 0 and the bending moment is 0, because at the pinned end bending moment is 0. So, those are the boundary conditions. So, coming back to our again this should be 2 primes, but it got corrected over here. EI constant, let us assume EI to be constant. So, this becomes now your governing equation EI d square d 4 v over d x 4 plus p over EI d square v over d x square equal to 0, and let us bring p over EI as lambda square. So, the governing equation is now v fourth prime plus lambda square v double prime equal to 0. So, assuming lambda square is greater than 0, that means it is under compressive load, okay, because we assumed p to be compressive when I derived this equation. If p was tensile, the sign would have been negative there, okay, and lambda would be still positive, but the sign would have been negative. Then the solution would have been different, okay, then it would not be sine and cosine, then it would have hyperbolic sine and hyperbolic cosine in it, okay, all right. So, this is now our deflection. This is the deflection for beam for our case. So, okay. So, our boundary conditions are v 1 0 at v 1 prime 0, the bending moment is 0, and this and the shear force is 0 at x equal to L. So, we are studying now the buckling of a clamped free boundary condition, right. Did I say that over here also? Yeah, critical load for clamped free boundary conditions. I forgot to mention that. So, you integrate this equation 4 times. Now, one thing that you would notice here is I should spend some time on this. The shear condition is no longer, if you do a simple analysis, you would notice that the shear force is no longer EI V triple prime like you see in the regular beam. The shear condition becomes EI, does it have over here? When we derived it, this is a shear, okay. So, you would notice that the shear force does not, and again once again these are 2 primes, not 3 primes. You would notice that the shear force is, this is what we have been using, this is what you guys have been using, EI d over dz EI v double prime. What the presence of axial force p does is, it adds this additional term to the shear force, p times dv over dz, okay. So, remember that. That the shear boundary condition is not as before just related to EI and V double prime, you also have one more term related to P over there. So we did that, this becomes our condition, this is the solution, first derivative, second, third, and you substitute the boundary condition and you get a set of 4 conditions that a 1 plus a 4 equal to 0, a 3 equal to 0, and so you guys see what I am saying, okay. So, I am writing now these are all equal to 0. So, I am writing these 4 conditions equal to 0 in matrix form in terms of a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4. So, when I do that I get set of these 4 equations with the right hand side equal to 0. Any questions up to this point? Okay. So, the same argument we had yesterday now. One solution to this problem is all my 4 coefficients equal to 0, right, but I do not care about that one. What I want to now find out is there a non-trivial V x for this problem, okay, and we would use the same argument we used last time. For this set of 4 equations to have a non-trivial values of a the only way from Cramer's rule that can happen is if the determinant of this 4 by 4 matrix is 0. You guys remember that Cramer's rule, right? So, from Cramer's rule this determinant has to be 0, and that determinant gives me this condition minus lambda 5 cosine lambda l equal to 0. So, in both in divergence and in buckling, if you do analytical methods, you get lot of equations like this. So, you have to be good at numerical methods to solve these kind of equations, but this is pretty straightforward. This tells us the only for beam to buckle cosine of lambda l equal to 0, and that would happen if lambda l is equal to 2 n minus 1 l over. So, there is a large number of values of lambda for which beam can buckle. These are called transcendental equation, right, and they have infinite number of roots, and you see a lot of them in vibrations of continuous systems also. Okay. So for every, so what it is saying is that not every single value of p I would have a non-trivial solution. First of all, only for a certain discrete set of values of p I will have a non-trivial solution. Those discrete values are called eigenvalues of this problem. This whole notion that we are talking about, it comes under what we call Sturm-Liouville problems. Have you guys heard that name before? In Sturm-Liouville problems, those are eigenvalue problems that govern the differential equation of certain systems, and we see them both in buckling and mechanical vibration of axial bars, beams, rods. Any continuous system can be expressed using what we call Sturm-Liouville eigenvalue problems. What that means is those problems only have solution at certain specific values of lambda. For example, when we look at our differential equation over here, there was this lambda there, right? So, this lambda would have a different meaning in mechanical vibration problems, and I will show it to you today. But these kind of differential equations do not have solutions for all values of lambda, only for certain specific values of lambda. Those values of lambda are called eigenvalues of the problem. The corresponding v's or the solution to the problems are called eigenvectors. Okay. Or for our case, the lambdas for which you do have a solution would be called buckling load, and there are many buckling loads, but the only one we are interested in is the lowest one. So, n equal to 1 is the only one I really care about, but you can have higher buckling loads also. Okay. But knowing about higher buckling load helps you, because you can see then what does that mode look like, and can I do something to my system to make it go more towards the second mode, like adding a spring here or adding a torsional spring there. That is how you increase the buckling load, either increase the value of EI or you restrain the motion by putting some springs. You know, like civil engineer, you would see some braces they put on the structures. That is what they are for, to increase the buckling load. So only for certain values of lambda we will have a solution to this problem, and that solution would be given by lambda equal to 2 n minus 1 l pi over 2, and they are all roots of this equation cosine lambda l equal to 0. And one of the solution of course is lambda equal to 0, but we do not care about that solution. Okay. Then for each value of lambda I can go back and I can substitute over here. Oh, before I do that, now that I know for what value of lambda this thing can have a solution, I will substitute that lambda here, and then I'll find my 4 unknowns. But like we said last time, you really cannot find 4 of them uniquely. You can only find 3 of them, and one of them you have to assume. So I can say I can assume A1 is 1, for example. Then I'll find A2. In terms of A1, A3 in terms of A1, A4 in terms of A1. You cannot find all 4 of them uniquely. That is the property of eigenvectors. So, in this case you are getting A1 and A3 equal to 0 and A2 equal to minus A4, and when you substitute this back you get the buckling mode looks like 1 minus cosine lambda n z. Okay. So, what it means is when this beam would buckle, its shape would look like this function. It is going to look like 1 minus cosine lambda l, and the critical first critical value is pi square e I over 4 l square. Do you guys, anybody remembers what the buckling load for a simply supported beam is? Pi square e I over l square. So, this is, so cantilever beam is pretty bad in resisting buckling. So, if I give you two beams, one is cantilever, one is simply supported, the cantilever is going to have 1/4 the buckling load of a simply supported. Any questions? And this is how these modes look like: the first mode, the second mode, the third mode. And these are some of the other buckling modes: is pinned, pi square e I over l square, clamped free, pi square. This is what we just did: both ends clamped. This is the highest. If you clamp both the ends, you get buckling load of 4 pi square e I over l square. Okay. And this one is 2.06 pi square e I. Sometimes people, you do not have to do fourth order differential equations. Many times, especially when the beam is simply supported, you can just do the entire analysis using second order differential equation, and in this case it becomes just a second order differential equation. And for simply supported, you really do not have to solve that fourth order, you could do for second order. Okay. And the same method, but the, and then if you have some kind of imperfections, like the load is really not applied through the center, remember I was telling you guys we get deflection right from the beginning. Okay. The reason we get deflection right from the beginning is many times the load has some what we call eccentricity, that it is not really applied through the central axis, it is applied through certain distance. And when that happens, you solve the problem and you get delta equal to y equal to a secant lambda l over 2 cosine lambda l. So, this is the solution, and that this is what happens as the imperfection increases, your deflection is really like this. The perfect case was, as we talked about, you go straight and then at the buckling you start to go that way, but because of these imperfections, because of this eccentricity in the load, you start to get the deflection right away, and so this is the deflection profile then of a beam which has a small imperfection in it. We have talked about this. This we won't go through it. This is buckling of short column. This is not of interest to you guys here. But what happens is when we assume this relationship, pi square e I over l square, and then we can write in terms of stresses. It assumes the material is elastic. But when you have short columns. When you have short columns, the stress you would calculate from this formula would be more than the yield stress. Okay. So, that means I have violated my assumption. That formula that we derived, buckling is pi square e I over l square or whatever it is for your case, it assumed the material is behaving in a linear elastic manner. Okay. But then I go back and find out the stress value, it comes out to be more than yield stress. So that means something is wrong there, right. So what people do is they have derived special formulas if the slenderness ratio of the beam is less than certain value. You first thing you want to make sure is when you get buckling load is, are you still under elastic, are you still in the elastic limit. Okay. If you are not in the elastic limit, you should not be using that formula. Then you have to make some modifications, and these slides would tell you what that modification is. So we are not going to discuss over this. So this is how it really looks like. This is what Euler equation tells us for large slender ratio. Euler equation is just fine. This thing that we derived, it was derived by Euler long time ago. So it's buckling, people have known about buckling since the time of Euler. Okay, but if slenderness ratio is less than this value, that makes it into plastic range. We have several formulas. One is called tangent modulus formula. One is called reduced model equation. So they are all given in any textbook on buckling, and you guys can see it from there. If you are dealing with the short columns, and this is just a method of studying short columns. So I'll skip this part. The other thing you need to worry about is when the beam is slightly deflected before you apply the loads. Okay, so there are two kinds of imperfections we worry about. One is when the load is not through the neutral axis. The other one is the beam already has a small out of plane deflection, and then the beam deflects like this. This we have talked to. This we don't have to talk about this. I mean, there's a method to solve these kind of problems, and I'll give these slides to Dr. Sunny, and he will let you guys have a look at them. Okay. So buckling is really that helped us a lot in understanding divergence, because it told people that there is a thing called elastic stability. There is a thing called in an elastic structure, when you give a small disturbance, it is possible that that disturbance might increase the value of load, or it might increase, in the case of buckling, the bending moment that would try to keep on deflecting it. And so when you give it that small disturbance, you have to look at what is it that is happening to your load, and is the structure has still enough stiffness to sustain that additional load or that additional moment that is coming into picture because of your small disturbance. If they balance out, you will be fine. If the restraining moment wins, then it's a stable system. If the restraining moment loses, then we are in trouble. Okay. So with that background, let's now go back to our divergence, not the section model, but more like the actual beam. Now, how do we study? Divergence of a beam. So last time we studied stopped over here, right? We found the divergence speed of a typical section model. This was our section model. So we said if I give a small disturbance, the angle of attack would increase, which would make the lift go up. That lift would increase the moment that would try to deflect this airfoil more, but our spring would try to prevent that. If at a certain speed the change in the aerodynamic moment becomes equal to the change in the value of the restoring moment, which is kt times delta theta, where delta theta is the small disturbance I give, then it would be neutral equilibrium. But if the aerodynamic moment increases compared to the value of our restoring moment, then it's going to keep on rotating more and more till either the beam, mathematically speaking, it would go to infinity because it's a loss of stability. But what happens before that is either the spring would break or the wing would stall. Okay, so what sometimes prevent things from going to infinity is stall, because wing cannot, at after a certain angle of attack, the wings cannot take any more lift. The lift falls down tremendously, right? So it can either stall or it would break. So this is what we did in the very first class to give you the notion of what aeroelasticity is all about. And it is pretty powerful simple example to do that, but let us see how it extends to an actual wing now. So, let us study the actual wing now. So, the key thing in divergence really is the torsional resistance of the wing. Okay. So, you have a straight wing, it is having its elastic axis nearly perpendicular to the airplane's plane of symmetry. This is the torsional, I take a small differential element of length dy. So, let us suppose on this side it is being subjected to a torque T, on the right hand side it is being subjected to a torque T plus dt over dy. So, I am taking this differential element that you see over here, right. This is our elastic axis, that means if a transverse load is applied through this point, it will not twist. Okay. This is called line of aerodynamic center, and we defined aerodynamic center last time. What is aerodynamic center? Is 0, right. So, this is the only point on an airfoil that if you see airfoil have lift and they have a pitching moment, everybody agrees. And the net effect that we are interested here is, so on the actual wing you are going to have a pressure distribution, but for studying divergence we especially if it is a very large aspect ratio wing and if it is a very large aspect ratio wing, we do not have to really look the pressure distribution everywhere, because the wing really behaves like a beam then. So, on a typical section we call it a strip theory. So, we are going to take this strip and we are going to say whatever pressure is acting on that strip on the wing, delta P, not the actual pressure, the pressure because there is a pressure on the top and the pressure on the bottom, right. It is a suction on the top and compression in the bottom, whatever is the net lift, whatever is the net force acting on that strip, we are going to convert it into just two quantities, the overall value of the lift and the overall value of the pitching moment acting through the aerodynamic center. Okay. And you can do that, you can do that. Yeah, is it very accurate? Yes, it turns out it is very accurate. But make sure that is an approximation of the actual loading acting on that strip. Actual loading on that strip really is a delta P, pressure distribution, right, which is changing from point to point. So, you take all that pressure distribution which is changing from point to point, but you convert it into just two quantities, the lift and the pitching moment. Okay. So let us say the lift is L and the pitching moment due to small disturbance is delta m. So, this is what is happening on that small strip, and v is the airspeed, alpha is the initial angle of attack. So, we are going to assume the lift and we have talked about this a lot, the lift and pitching moment act at the aerodynamic center. An aerodynamic center again is a point about which the pitching moment is independent of the angle of attack, like somebody was saying dm over d alpha is 0. Okay. And that is a very good thing to know, because it really makes our analysis very simple. And we do not worry about the drag force, for these calculations we do not worry about the drag force. So, you take that differential element and remember now it is under torque. Okay. So, this is a moment equilibrium about the elastic axis in terms of the torque. Okay. So, take 2 minutes and write the equilibrium equation of this small strip. And then we will compare it with what I have on the slide. So, satisfy sum of all the torques equal to 0 and see what do you get. all you have to do is sum all the torques around the elastic axis. Okay, so that's very important. So you need to know this, that there's the aerodynamic center is at a distance E times C. C is a chord and E is a non-dimensional number. So and the torque is around the elastic axis. This is what you would get, right? Did you guys get this? Okay, and then put the value of delta moment aerodynamic from aerodynamic theory 1/2 rho v square c square c m 0, and delta y is delta y. Let's look into delta l first. Lift is 1/2 rho v square s c l, right? And s for is area of that strip, which comes out to be c times delta y. So we are using the fact that lift on a wing, on in this case on a small strip, can be we represent it as L equal to 1/2 rho. Rho, what is rho? Density of the air. V square, V is velocity of the air. S surface area into C L. C L is lift coefficient, right? So area is C times delta y. Because we are interested in that strip, and the area of the strip is chord into dy. Okay, when you go to moment, now moment is has units of newton meters, right? So to non-dimensionalize it, instead of just using c delta y, we have to use, and we have to bring another c. Okay, so that's why you see 1/2 rho v square s c into delta y is s, then c another that makes it c square. Okay, into c m 0. CM0 is pitching moment coefficient. CM0 is pitching moment coefficient. Now, we are going to assume small angles. When you assume small angles, CL can be written as CL0, that means the lift coefficient at 0 angle of attack plus partial CL over partial alpha into alpha plus theta, because it is linear, right? And from the torsional theory, T equal to g j d theta over d y. Everybody remembers that? It is equivalent of m equal to e I d square v over d x square. For torsion, it is this. Substitute everything over here and you will look at this messy equation. So this becomes a torsional equation once you replace your applied torque with the contribution coming from the lift and the contribution coming from the pitching moment. Right, it's pretty straightforward. So we're going to assume GJ is uniform, and one of the things I'm going to teach you is what happens when GJ is not uniform. Okay, so we will go back to our principle of virtual work and the expansion method. So you guys learned a very powerful technique yesterday, how to represent approximate solution of differential equations using trial functions. Using a series of expansion, principle of virtual work, and you assume your approximate solution as a series of functions, and then learn how to find those coefficients. So you will see that that comes out very handy to us when we would do divergence of a non-uniform wing, because I cannot really solve this differential. Here I would be able to solve it exactly, because everything is constant coefficient. Nothing is dependent on x. The moment any of these things become a function of x, I would have very hard time solving this this differential equation exactly. Okay, so I'm assuming GJ to be uniform, and when we do that, on the left hand side you have d square theta dy square plus 1/2 rho v square. Everything related to theta is on the left hand side. Everything you already have is on the other side. Okay, the alpha is your initial angle of attack, and the our boundary conditions are at wing root theta equal to 0 and gj d theta by dy 0 at the free end, okay, because you're not applying any torque there. Everybody agrees? Okay. And so the general solution to this would be, first see what happens when the right hand side is 0, that is our homogeneous part, and then we would do the particular integral for this special right hand side. So the particular integral simply comes out to be in this case minus CL 0, okay. So if you substitute this over there, you will see your differential equation is satisfied. What really is of interest to us is this guy. The homogeneous solution is what we are really after, okay. And this would be, and I have, what I have done is I have converted this whole thing 1/2 rho v square E c square, this whole thing into lambda square, just like we did for buckling. We do the same thing here also, we do the same thing here also, and I get the homogeneous part equal to a sin lambda y plus b cosine lambda y, okay. So the lambda square comes out to be this. So the particular, the total solution becomes now to our problem theta y equal to a sin lambda y plus b cosine lambda y and the particular integral part. You apply the boundary conditions, we get our two coefficients a and b. So theta y then comes out, this is our b, this is our a, and theta y comes out to be then this big expression over here. Okay. So all I am doing really is I am going over here to this equation and I am substituting these two conditions, that theta is 0 at y equal to 0 and d theta by dy is 0 at y equal to s, s is the end point. So it is pretty straight, that part is not very difficult, and you get your two coefficients b and a. You so this is your overall solution to the problem. And this, we just simplify this one little bit and it comes out to be, this part comes out to be cosine lambda s minus y over cosine lambda s minus 1 over 0, and you would see why I did that. What would happen if cosine lambda s goes to 0? No, I am talking about this cosine lambda s going to 0, theta would become infinite, very large. So that, so that is problem point for us, lambda s going to 0 means trouble, okay. So when would lambda s go to 0? If lambda s is equal to either pi over 2, 3 pi, just like buckling, okay. So once again now it is a, it has become a sort of eigenvalue problem, okay. So for certain value, see this part is particular integral, so it is going to be there regardless of that. What we are saying now is, if I was giving it a small disturbance, this is what you would be seeing, this is what you would be seeing, okay, because that part is there all the time, that gives you basic equilibrium. This would give you the additional part with the small disturbance. So when lambda s go to pi over 2, we have a problem, okay. And then I can, we from here we can find our, that speed at which lambda s will go to pi over 2, and that is called divergence speed. So this is our divergence speed. So what would you do to increase the divergence speed of a wing? Increase the torsional stiffness, that is number 1. What is the problem with that? Weight, right? I mean we are aerospace engineers, we do not like weight. So but you can, you can increase GJ if you, within still staying within the, that is the first thing. What else can we do from this relation? increase what? Lift curve slope, but that's pretty much fixed. You can't go too high. What, for low speed, what's partial CL over partial alpha, the analytical value? 2 pi, right? There's not much I can do there either. So what else can we do? This E, right? This E is also, that's the only thing you can play with. So if you can make the aerodynamic center and the elastic axis come closer to each other, do I want closer? No, I want them far away. Closer, I'm sorry, yes, closer, right? So I want E to be small. I want E to be small. Okay. Okay, so that's a very good question. Real structures, what would happen? Real structures have sweep. Okay, one of the things you want to learn is when we go to this approximate method, I really want to calculate the divergence speed of a swept wing. One of the things you are going to see is when the wing is swept, I cannot use pure torsion. I have to bring in bending also into picture. So you have to hold on to that question, that what happens in real wings. If the real wing is straight, this is what would happen. Okay. Now, when you say, when you ask me this question, would the divergence happen, what did you have in mind? It would happen. I mean, this tells me it would happen. It can have a very high speed, but it would happen. Now, the question is, would it happen within your design limit? I don't know. I mean, you will have to make, you will do the calculations and you will make sure that it does not happen within your flight regime that you are interested in. Okay. Now, for swept back wings, we have a very good news. It does not happen, and you will see that it, or it happens at such a high speed that you do not have to worry about it. Remember this, let us go back to that picture. Let me, I'll go back to that picture, let me see what else is, yeah, it is here, but I will tell you the mechanism why it does not happen in, or happen at a very high speed, but we will do the actual math later on. So, here is a swept back wing, right, and your V is coming over here. And for a swept back wing, the neutral the elastic axis is like this. Okay, so you can assume for a very large aspect ratio, it would be like, it would be fixed more like this. Okay, so now look at these two points A and B. First, look at A and B. At A and B, they both gonna have the same bending stiffness. Sorry, bending deflection. So whatever A is going up, B is also going up, but if you draw another line like this parallel but coming from A prime is the direct in the direction of the streamline, not stream, airflow, right. So when this beam would deflect in bending, which point you think would have more deflection, this one or this one? First, this one, right. So, it is going to have more deflection. So, what then happens is, because this one has more deflection, this point would have lesser deflection compared to deflection of A prime is same as this one, deflection of B is same as this one. If B is higher than A prime, what can you say about the angle of attack of A prime B? It has increased or decreased? Decreased, because B is going up with respect to A prime. Okay, so bending has helped you. So that's why swept back wings are very good when it comes to divergence. And we will do the math, and you will see that. So all transport airplanes have sweep going back, and the opposite would happen if it were swept forward. That's why you don't see many swept forward wings. And we'll answer that question again: how can we have swept forward wings, even though we know from aerodynamics, even though we know from stability and control, swept forward wings are better than swept back wings, but we still don't use them. And this is one reason, that swept back wings prevent divergence. Swept forward make life hard. Their divergence speed is less than swept back wing. Okay. and we are going to do the math how to calculate actual divergence speed. Okay. And this all explains what I just explained to you. So, the airfoil on A prime B steam wise action will have a net reduction in angle of attack, and you guys told me that is what would happen. Okay. The corresponding negative increment of lift reduce the deflection of the wing, thereby the possibility of wing disturbance. I should say reduce the angle of attack of the wing. The divergence speed of swept back wing is so high that it poses no problem. Okay. Reverse happens for swept forward wings, that is why we do not see many swept forward wings. Okay. So, let us take a 5 minutes break and come back and go to the next topic.